we're saying no. The Gospel of John, chapter 20. And chapter 21. No, I'm not going to preach two whole chapters. I might. Rusty old halo and a skinny white cloud. Ever hear that? That old song? Do you really think that's what heaven is to you? What do you think heaven will be? What do you want to see in heaven? What do you want to experience in heaven? What do you think about heaven? We all think about it. A lot of the concepts of heaven, truly, are not necessarily from God's Word. There are ideas and notions that we've picked up over the years and heard from other persons. But are they real? Streets of gold, are they 24 karat, 12 karat? What are they? Walls of the gems and the stones and the gates of pearls. What will you see in heaven? What will you do in heaven? Do you really think you're going to just sit around singing hymns all the time? I don't think so. Maybe you will. What do you know about what you will see in heaven? The library in Alexandria, Egypt, was the largest, most renowned library in the ancient world, and it was destroyed, burned, consumed. 164 million plus books are in the Library of Congress, Washington, D.C. And then, of course, we have the Boyle's Library. Libraries all over the world. How many books are there to be reading? In John chapter 20, verse 30, and in John chapter 21, verse 24 and following, is somewhat instructive to us. The one thing I'm going to see in heaven and experience in heaven and do in heaven is meet the millions upon millions upon millions of believers. I want to sit down and talk to Abel, who was murdered when he gave his offering back in the book of Genesis. I want to know more about his offering. I want to know more about where he learned how to do that. When Jesus went home with Zacchaeus, the tax collector, they came out of the house, Zacchaeus was a believer, but he hadn't been when he went in. We don't have a single word of what Jesus said to him in the house. I want to know. I'm going to meet Zacchaeus, we're going to sit down, and we're going to have a chat. David in the psalmist, over 40 years ruled his nation. There's only a few chapters in our Bible. Do you think everything he said, everything he did, everything he thought, every experience that he had, do you think that's in the Bible? It isn't. You think you have it all in the Bible. You don't. You are just scratching the surface. If you could memorize all of the Bible, every word of it, 66 books, you still would be like a teaspoonful of water in the Pacific Ocean. You don't know. There's so many. Jesus spent 40 days with his 11 disciples after his resurrection. What did they talk about? There's not a word in here about that. We don't know. I want to know. I want to know. There's so much we do not know that we can know and we will know when we are in heaven. There's people you're going to meet, unbelievable number of people with tremendous experiences. You're just scratching the surface here on this earth. What we have in God's Word right here is incomplete. Yes, I said that. This is not complete. This is just touching on it. This is just a smattering of it. There's so much more that we can learn, and that's what we're going to be doing in heaven. Learning, 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 growing, 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 experiencing, experiencing, experiencing. John chapter 21, verse 24 says these words to us. This is the disciple, John, the writer of this. This is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his, John's, testimony is true. Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. It's an endless bookshelf. It goes on and on and on. We're going to know things Jesus said. We're going to know things that Jesus did. We're going to know things that Jesus experienced that are not even in this book. You just have a touch of it right here. Now what we have is affirmed by the apostles. It's true. It's God's word. We can trust it. We can believe it. The church all through these 21 centuries have verified this as God's word. It is God's word. But it's not everything there is to know because there's so much more. What are you going to do in heaven? Ultimate knowledge. Can't wait to get there. Because of what I'm going to learn, what I'm going to experience, it's not just going to be strumming on a guitar and singing a song. It's going to be hearing and knowing and experiencing the things of Jesus that are forever and forever. This is an incomplete revelation, and yet it's a complete revelation for your salvation. It's all you need to be saved. It's all you need to know the Lord in this life and here. John chapter 20, verse 30 and 31. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you can have life. There's enough here to have salvation. There is enough here to become a believer. There is enough here to know that you are going to be able to go to heaven. But there's so much more yet to learn. It's written to give you belief. That's why, as David so often does in our Bible study hour, no, I'm not going to hit you again with it, though I ought to, because you did not come even after last Sunday. I said you should come to Bible study. What are you smirking for? Come on. Stop. He studies. Do you know how much he studies? He's got books and books and books. There's one. I love my man. Scares me to death to know what's in all those books compared to what I know. And I thank you for that. And some of you come with with comments and with ideas and with thoughts that I never would have had. Wow, we have a good class. We are growing. We are learning. We are knowing. And it gives you belief. But what does belief do for you? It gives you eternal life. I'm not saved by memorizing the Bible. I'm not saved by going to church. I'm not saved even by walking it out and giving a profession of faith. I am saved by the Word of God that gives me a belief that grows and grows and grows and grows. It is so wonderful. And in heaven, we will know it all. We don't know it all here. It's incomplete in this book, but it's complete to give you salvation. And it's complete to give you transformation. You've got to change. You've got to be different. 2 Peter tells us this in 3:18. But grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. I want to know more than I knew yesterday. I want to know so much more than I knew when I accepted Christ as my Savior. I don't want to. I see so many Baptists. They made a profession of faith. They believe. I believe them. They're saved. But it's like they're still living in yesterday. I want to live in today, and I want to live in tomorrow, and I want to know more about. I love that song, more about Jesus. That's what we need. And grow, and let it change you. But your salvation is not perfect, not here. It's a progress. It's a work in progress. It will not become truly perfect until Jesus comes and you go with him. Dear friends, we are told in 1 John, now we are the children of God. There's no doubt about that. I believe that. You are the children of God. And what we shall be, what we will be, has not been made known. But we know this, that when Christ appears, when he comes, his advent, his second advent, when he comes, we shall be like him. Aren't you glad to know I'm not going to be like me and you? Sometimes I'm not very nice, right? Sometimes you're not very nice. But when Jesus comes, oh, I can't wait to see you and know you then. And you can't wait to see me and know me then, because we'll be really perfected. All that is gone. Thank God it is gone. Perfect salvation will only be in eternity. I have been saved, I'm being saved, and I will be saved finally one day. It's a work in progress. And I'll be just like Jesus. Okay, I'll close with this. Some of you that were here back in the 80s will remember. You remember Lawrence King? Lawrence King came here from Missouri. Had a lot of farmers come here from Missouri. Planted beans. I drove the truck that his machine put the beans in my truck. Took it up to the little co-op. And I lost my Louisiana college class ring on that in a float of mine. I don't know where that is now. But I remember Lawrence, but more than that, I remember his wife. They used to come here. She liked to memorize scripture. She memorized the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Word for word, King James Bible for sure. She memorized it. She asked me one time, Brother Nathan, I'd like to get in front of the church and give my recitation. Okay. She did. She stood right up there. She gave every word of the Sermon on the Mount. But you know what? She could have memorized all of it from Genesis to Revelation. I never met anyone that did, but she could have. Wouldn't save her. You can read it all. It won't save you. It won't change you. The only way you're changed is when God's word comes into your heart and stirs it up and turns you inside out and upside down and makes you a whole new creature. That's a miracle. And it goes on and on and on all through life. Memorizing the scripture, reading the scripture, knowing the scripture is not the same as living the scripture.